So first of all, the headline here. We are going to cover one of the cheapest stock in Scandinavia that we think is a turnaround that is still going unnoticed by most investors. Just our own disclaimer here. Nathaniel mentioned his. I'll not repeat this one. It will be on our website. We will publish a full report after this session. But everyone should read this disclaimer before making any moves in the stock. Today, Symmetry Invest do own shares in the stock, so please have this in mind. Just a quick snapshot of what we're going to discuss here today. This is a company that we think is the cheapest one in Scandinavia now. The price to earning or free cash flow yield of this stock is dropping to 4.4 next year and going to 2.5 the next year. It's an asset-light model with structural growth, and it's basically priced for bankruptcy, despite the fact that it doesn't have a lot of debt. First, we are going to mention an iGaming company today. And before mentioning the name, we wanted to kind of disclose our track record doing iGaming investments. We think that's quite valuable because we have really good returns with this in the past. As can be seen from the slide here, our 7 largest investments in the past in iGaming stocks has returned 233% over only 16 months. So that's more than 100% IRR. And we think this investment we mentioned today is at least equally good. So how have we been able to do this? Something is our industry knowledge we have built over a long time. Another thing is that the fund is founded by the founders of Better Collective. And the last point is that our portfolio manager, Henrik Abrahamsen, has spent more than 10 years in the industry. So we've built a lot of connections there. Let's introduce Gaming Innovation Group then. So Gaming Innovation Group is a technology and affiliate supplier to the iGaming industry. It's dual listed in both Oslo and in Stockholm. The stock dropped 85% from July of 2018 and over the next 30 months and hit a low of 3 Norwegian kroner. And just to have this in mind, to go back to the old all-time high would yield 700% there. And there has been zero dilution in the share count since. We actually had a position there in the past and took a big loss on this position as we lost the faith in prime management. But since we sold our shares, which seems quite wise now, the stock dropped 80% more. After a new management team have came in and cleaned up the company, we have been building a stake in the company again and think the setup is really, really good from here. A quick mention of the turnaround process. As you can see from the chart before, Geek had quite a past with broken promises, with too high debt, and a primary promotional CEO. The board of directors put in a new, the shareholders put in a new board of directors in December of 2018, that was headed by the former CEO of Unibet called Peter Nylander. The board then took a new strategy where they wanted to align the company on a new focus. They wanted to reduce the debt that was too high and also reduce the cost structure. They started to talk with the founder and at that time CEO about this new strategy. But after some talks back and forth, they decided that a new management team was needed. So in 2019, September, they fired the founder and they hired Richard Brown as CEO. Richard has quite quickly went to work here. Here is just 8 things he has done since he became CEO 14 months ago. He started to close down the loss-making game studio. So before, Geek was trying to develop their own casino games and distribute those to the platform customers. In theory, that made sense because they could upsell their own content. But what actually happened was that they couldn't develop good enough games. So then they were stuck with the problem of distributing games that was not good enough and then making a bad product for the end user, or they couldn't resell some much better products from alternative suppliers. Richard chose the wise thing there and shut down the game studio and saved a lot of money. Another thing the prime management team didn't do was they didn't invest back into the media segment. The media segment was treated more as a cash cow. Richard quickly reversed this and started to reinvest back into the business, and then has already turned it to a growth story again. He then sold the B2C unit. Before, Geek also had a B2C unit that was in competition with their own B2B customers. They used this proceeds to pay down the debt and then restore the balance sheet. Another thing was they aligned the cost structure. The company had some quite lavish cost structure before, and the new management team quickly cut a lot of employees and a lot of excessive costs, and now have created a company culture around new goals. They then reorganized the loss-making sports segment. This has been a segment that has been losing money for at least the last 5 years, and it had no future prospects around becoming profitable. They then signed a highly attractive joint venture in this segment. They completed the heavy tech development. They had a lot of products, a lot of migrations to a new platform where they are now done with this, or will be done in Q1 next year. They phased out the old risky white label business. So the company was basically selling mostly white label contracts on their own license and had now moved the business into a total SaaS deal. They have then signed a lot of new customers to the platform, as I will walk through later. Here's just a few examples of what happened. We can see the chart to the right, the cost structure, where they have already taken the cost downs a lot. And then there is a few examples from the media here on the left, where they closed the game studio, they signed the platform, or sorry, the sportsbook deal with BetGenius, and then they divested the B2C vertical to Betsson Group. And it seems to work. Here you can see the figures, and then I put a nice picture of Richard in here where he became the CEO. And as you can see here, he actually turned the company from losing slightly below a million euro in EBITDA every quarter, and now they are becoming profitable. And the current guidance for Q4 supposes a quarterly EBITDA of 4.4 million. So the trend seems to continue here. And despite all this, the stock has yet to react on the news. Just a quick mention on the online gambling industry, just in general. What we have seen over the past 5 years in online gambling has been a big transition from offline to online. That has come because of adoption of mobile phones and better internet connections. So while users have been moving from laptops to mobile, they're spending a lot more time on the mobile. And as the internet connection is better now, they are much easier for them to play online games. Another thing that has happened is that before most countries was operating in a black market, where now most countries are regulating the industry. GiG stands to profit from this. They are one of the few providers that is helping land-based casinos moving online. So as we see less mature markets in high-growing countries, well, populations that is adapting to mobile and online, GiG will take a big market share of this. So where are we now? GiG has three divisions now: the media division, a platform division, and a sportsbook division. We will spend some time walking through all three segments now. First is the media division. In GiG Media, they operate an affiliate business. They generate traffic on send traffic to operators on a performance marketing model. You can compare this a little bit to the booking industry, where you will find a hotel through booking.com and they will compare all the hotels there. It's basically the same thing that is happening in publishing sites on online casinos, where you can go in, Google an online casino, you will find one of GiG's websites, and there you can compare the different casinos and see which ones have the best bonus plays, the lowest fee structure, and so on. You will then click on one of those casinos and be directed to them and start playing. The money you lose there, GiG will normally take a revenue share on that the operators will pay them. You can see some of the competitors GiG have there in below the left side. That's mostly Catena Media and Better Collective that is the main one. What is happening is, you can see the chart below on the right, they are building perpetual revenue share. So what is normally happening is that you send a cohort of NDCs, what is called new depositing customers, to the operators. Normally there's a big churn of those in the start, as there's a lot of bonus seekers that play their bonuses and then move on. But for each cohort, there's a lot of there's a long valuable tail that keeps paying revenue share for years afterwards. And as Gig has been in this industry for some time now, they have built a lot of those profitable tails with a lot of different operators. One of their competitors, XL Media, put two great slides in their investor presentations I have used here. Basically, you can see the two different models of getting users. One is publishing, where you run high value content websites. You try to rank them high on Google. Players will come to Google and search for a casino site or a sports betting site. They will then find a Geek's site there and go to Bet365 or another bookmaker and start playing. The other way to get NDCs is through paid marketing. And this is an area where Geek is actually the market leader now. Geek is paying with their own money for ads on Facebook. It could be YouTube, Google AdWords, Instagram, or whatever. So they buy the ads through their own money and then display an marketing campaign for one of the operators, and then hopefully can convert this to a paying user and get revenue share as they get in the publishing segment. And there's a lot of optimizations going on here. So every time Geek buys an ad, they need to know, okay, what should we place in this ad? What should we pay for it? What operator should we direct the customer to? How long should we use the ads, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And as they gather more and more data, they will be a lot better to do this over time. In publishing, there's been a lot of good competitors in this industry, but in the paid media side, Geek has been really one of the leaders there. That basically came after they bought a Copenhagen business called Rebel Penguin back in 2017. What the old management didn't do was they didn't reinvest back in the media segment. So they mostly used the segment as a cash cow to fund the losses in the other segments. And as you didn't invest in this industry, you're not keeping your sites good enough. And when your sites is not content rich and the people is not investing in technology, your Google will start deranking some of your sites. This is basically what happened with Geek back in 2019 after the Swedish regulation also kicked in. And you can see here why the revenue was dropping quarter after quarter and hit a low there in Q4 last year. As Richard came in, he quickly wanted to reverse this trend. And here's what's happened. As you can see, Richard became CEO at the exact low point in Q4 2019. He then started to reinvest more into the media segment. He promoted Jonas Vara, some was the founder of Rebel Penguin. And they started to diversify the business into new geographies, new verticals, and new business channels. And you can see from the chart that the revenue base has just kept improving quarter after quarter after Richard was taking over as CEO. And based on the current guidance for Q4, it seems that they could reach a new all-time high already now. So we think this is a quite remarkable achievement he has already done in so short time frame. Then how should we value Geek Media? The two biggest competitors to them is Catena Media and Betco. Betco is probably the best in this industry. They have the best track record, the best organic growth rate, and some of the most valuable assets. Catena Media has a really strong US position and a strong position in Japan, but on the other side have some really bad assets in Europe. Gaming Innovation Group is the strongest one in paid media and is growing the fastest there. All the last four quarters, I have shown the revenue here on the right side, so yeah, you can compare the different companies. As can be seen, was Better Collective had a really good start to this year with really high sportsbook margins in the first quarter. This trend reversed in the second quarter as COVID put a big decline in the Better Collective's business that is sports heavy. While Catena Media and Gaming Innovation Group has a stable growth over those quarters. But at least from this chart, you can see that the revenue growth has been quite equal between the companies now for the last few quarters. Paid media. So paid media is the crown jewel in Geek's media division, is our opinion. In the last quarter, the paid media channels grew 50% year over year and 10% quarter over quarter, and they started to diversify the business into new channels and geographies. And this growth has not been, you know, unheard in the industry there. So the market leader industry Better Collective actually bought an other paid media group called Atemi Group for 44 million euro. And just in comparison, Game Innovation Group currently have a market cap of only 60 million. Right now, Geek is also taking the paid media division into the US, that is an expanding market. So how should we put a valuation on it? As can be seen from the table down right, Better Collective and Catena Media is currently trading at quite high multiples. Better Collective multiple is probably a little lower in reality as the current earnings are depressed due to lower sports activities. But we think, as we said before, that Better Collective is deserving to trade at a premium due to their good track record. But we think a fair valuation for Geek should at least be 8x EBITDA, which is still a slight discount to Catena Media. If we use 8x running EBITDA, then we put a valuation on 140 million euro for Geek Media. Then let's talk about the other segment, the platform segment. The platform segment is basically the backbone of an iGaming operator. This is the player account management system that runs everything there. So here you have all the APIs, the integration with payments, the affiliate services, the ancillary service, and the game suppliers, etc. So every iGaming company needs a player account management system that handles the wallet and all the technology. Over the last 3 years, Geek has totally rebuilt their platform and have launched a lot of new features as an open marketplace. So Geek has built a new data platform, a new front-end structure, and new management tools like Logic and Comply that can integrate with a lot of ancillary services and making this platform an easy plug-and-play for iGaming operators to use. And as I said before, a lot of the things that is happening now in the industry is that retail casinos want to move online. But for them to move online, they need to have a good technology provider. So they are going to Gaming Innovation Group. And Geek is then helping those retail casinos by making them an online presence or an omnichannel presence. What is also happening is that is a lot of countries, the regulators is only handling a limited amount of skins to the operators. So that could be in the US where every state has a limited amount of skins. And this means that there is only a limited amount of operators that can operate there. So by Geek going in and partnering with some of the operators, it means they would take quite a big market share in some of the markets. And making a good platform is not easy. This is something we have seen with a lot of operators that fails here. Even a big company like Flutter has outsourced to 3-4 different operators, different platforms. So who's the competitors? When Geek launched their iGaming cloud, as Geekcore was called before, they mainly operated in the white label business. So in this business, the main competitors was Aerimatrix or Aspire Global. But over the last 2 years, Geek has moved basically all their platform business to a new SaaS model where they have gone away from the white label business. In a white label business, Geek is basically out-licensing their own license. So this have a lot of risk for Geek as the operators, as Geek is, you know, liable for all the wrongdoings the operators are making there. But on the new platform business, on the new SaaS model, Geek is competing primarily with Playtech or Nux or Oryx or GAN. Oryx and GAN is the pure place in this industry as Playtech and Nux also have some different other verticals. So I call this a slight divide and conquer, and there's some truth to it. So GAN is really, really successful in Italy and in US, and they are the market leader in those two markets. Playtech is primarily dominating the UK business where they originated from. Oryx has a strong position in Germany that is undergoing regulation now. But what is, you know, in common between those three competitors is that they are all looking to the US market now. So as the US is opening up, Geek is seeing all their competitors fighting for deals there. And this has really opened the rest of the world for Geek to take on some really good deals. So over the last 6 months, we have seen Geek signing deals in places like New Zealand, Macedonia, Hungary, Argentina, Latam, etc. So we see Geek taking a lot of deals in different markets all over the world now. Historically, Geek had a problem signing new SaaS contracts to the platform, and there was two reasons for this. One thing was that Geek also operated a B2C business. And as said before, operators didn't want to put their technology with Geek if Geek were running a competitor to them. The other thing was that Geek had a historical tech platform that needed to be migrated to the new platform. And operators didn't want to sign to an old platform and then be migrated. But what have happened over the last 6 months is that Geek has resolved those two problems and then have started to sign a lot of operators. So you can see from the chart to the right here that in 2018, they signed 2 operators. In 19, they signed 4. And so far this year, they have already signed 10 new operators. And the management team are saying they expect to sign more before the year end. One thing that also happened was COVID. So as retail casinos all over the world was mandated to shut down the operation and a lot of traffic went online, land-based casinos are now realizing that there is a huge need for an omnichannel solution. And Geek stands to benefit from this as they are one of the leading providers of omnichannel solutions. Also, the quality of the operators they're signing is going up. You can see some of those operators to the right there, but they have signed one of the largest casinos in Macedonia, Grupo Slots, one of the leading entertainment businesses in Argentina, Casinowin, one of 3 casinos in Hungary, Chipwin, the leading retail business in Germany, Slotbox, the leading retail business in Ireland, etc., etc. So we think that there is a lot of traction going on now, and as said, the management team expects to sign even more deals here. Another thing that is happening is that those retail customers, when you sign them on, there is a huge retention on those as they cannot just switch provider later on. But as I said, quality of the platform, actions speak louder than words. One thing is all the retail partners that is choosing Geek. That could be due to pricing, due to the omnichannel approach, etc. But what really amazes us now is that we are seeing actually online-only operators also choosing Geek's platform. 3 examples of this is a company called Bet7 that launched an online business. This is a former Geek employee called Tim Parker that is leading this business. So here you actually have an former Geek employee that has grown with this platform at Geek, has seen it being developed and now choosing this platform in another role he has. Then we have Dunder. Dunder is one of the white label contracts on Geek's platform. They are owned by a company called Kasumu that have their own platform. So there have always been this rumor in the market that at some point Kasumu will take Dunder's platform in-house. But what actually happened was Kasumu, instead of taking it in-house, they actually launched a new brand with Geek called Kasum Casino. And afterwards, they also signed a new agreement for the Dunder deal as a SaaS deal. So actually, instead of taking it in-house, they're outsourcing even more to Geek. The last thing that happened was with Betsson. So Betsson was the buyer of Geek's B2C business. Most people also thought that they will leave Geek's platform at some point. But again, what happened here was that Betsson have actually taken 4 platforms they had in the UK and consolidating everything on Geek's platform. So here you have some online-only operators with their own platform that is still choosing to go with Geek. So how should we look at the numbers here? As you can see on the slides here, the business is growing quite fast. It was growing 50% year over year and 15% quarter over quarter. Also, you can see from the EBITDA levels there that the business is now turning profitable. Actually, I said it would be profitable in September and going forward. But what is not seen in these numbers is the huge pipeline of customers they have already signed, but that is not launched yet. And this is something that will give a lot of revenue coming in the future. You can see that here, the Geek Core was transferring all their white label contracts to SaaS businesses. So despite the fact that the number of operators on the platform was declining from 30 to 23, the total revenue was growing as the average revenue per customer was going up. And you can see from the top in the right that the platform database transaction was going up and the GGR on the platform was going up. So the quality of the operators is becoming much, much higher as they are shifting from white label to SaaS. And here's the important part. As you can see here, the actually pipeline of operators that is signed but not yet live is expanding significantly. At the end of Q3, they have 15 operators in the pipeline that was already signed, where Geek has paid commission to the sales force, legal expenses, etc., but that is not yet generating revenue. They have actually signed 2 more in Q4 already and expect to sign more. So all the revenue now is coming from those 15 SaaS deals plus the 8 remaining white labels, while the company has double that amount in the pipeline already. So how should we value GeekCore? If you look at the peers, the main peers is Brack and GAN. So GAN is the market leader in the US now and the market leader in Italy. GAN is listed on the US stock exchange and the stock has been up 500% this year, and Symmetry was a former owner in GAN. Brack is listed in Canada and they are also growing quite fast but have some troublesome business in Germany. But we also like Brack as a business. And so how should we value it? We think GAN still deserves to trade at a premium multiple. But we think a fair multiple for GAN should be 8 to 12 times, while Geek and Brack should trade between 5 and 8 times. In the chart here, we use 6 times revenue as a multiple, and that would make a 130 million euro valuation on GeekCore. The last segment is Geek Sport. So this is the historic problem child for Geek. The old management was spending 5 years burning a lot of money on this, and they had really nothing to show for it, despite losses and losses. We had a lot of talks with the prior management about this business, and we basically told them to integrate with other providers like Cambi and SBTech and close their own investment. We actually also thought this is what Richard was going to do, but then he struck what really is a masterpiece of a deal with BetGenius. Instead of shutting it down, he created a joint venture with BetGenius. BetGenius, if you don't know them, is the second largest data provider in the industry. They are targeting a US IPO now at a $1.5 billion valuation. That is 25 times the valuation of Geek. And they sit on valuable data rights to, example, the Premier League, etc. You can see some of the revenue numbers there from BetGenius in below. But what is really happening now is that they are creating a technology platform where Geek is coming with all the technology and BetGenius is coming with all the trading tools and the risk management. So basically, they're taking the best from both and want to create a new sports betting product that is competitive with SBTech, etc. So this was the 3 segment. Then I'll just summarize the case here. What has happened over the last 2 years is that there has been a lot of significant selling pressure in the stock, and that is due for 4 reasons. One was that Norwegian index funds started to sell the stock as they made the dual listing in Stockholm. Then we saw index funds also selling it due to like ETFs as the company moved from mid-cap index down to the small-cap index. Then the old founder and the co-founder owned around 10% of the shares in this business. And as they were laid off last year, they started to sell their shares. So those close to 10% of the shares has been sold in the open market. But really, we only see upside from now on in this. One thing is that when they consolidate the listing in Sweden only, we will start to see Swedish ETF funds buying the stock. And another thing is that in the US, there's a high growing ETF called BETS. And as you can see at the right side there, Geek has currently the lowest allocation in this ETF. And this is due to, you know, the volume in Geek and the results they have had. We think that as the volume in Geek stock goes up and as they improve the profitability going forward, that this ETF would have to buy between 2 and 3% of all the shares in Geek. So that would put a lot of buying pressure on the stock instead of selling pressure that we have in the past. Just about the synergies between the segments. We see a lot of synergies between both the media and the platform business. When retail casinos go online, they want a turnkey solution. They don't want to go just online and then have to figure out, okay, how do we acquire customers? How do we do customer support? How do we do retention models, etc., etc.? So when they can go with Geek's platform service, Geek can also help them with affiliate leads, with media managed services, with SEO marketing, etc. And one example is the leading New Zealand-based entertainment business called Sky City. Based to our knowledge, Sky City only has 2 employees working in online, and then Geek is handling everything else from customer support to technology to marketing to payments, etc., etc. So here, Geek basically acts as the de facto operator for Sky City. But you know, if the valuation gap to the competitors is not closing, we definitely think the board will take decisive actions to unlock the full value here. And this could be through either a spin-off, it could be a sale of the company, sale of one division, et cetera. But we think this huge discount there is in the stock right now needs to be closed one way or another. Then the last 3 slides I have on the valuation. So what should we think about the long-term margins for Geek? In the right slide, I have shown how the EBITDA margin for the competitors is in the B2B business. So here you can see that the average is around 46% EBITDA margins. This is structurally high EBITDA margin business. And actually, we think both GAN and Kambi underlying EBITDA will be better than this. And that will push the industry average up to 50%. In our model, we still use 40% for Geek. And actually, already in Q4 2020, the implied margin from the current guidance Geek is providing is more than 30%. So they are already quite close to this EBITDA margin target. We value Geek using 2 models, either a sum of the parts model. So as said before, we use a sum of the parts where we value the media division at 8x EBITDA and the platform division at 6x revenue. And as mentioned before, this is actually a discount to comparable companies. And as you can see from the slide, the chart on the right side there, the valuation for Geek is significantly higher using a sum of the parts compared to the competitors. Actually, the fair value for Geek should be between 27 and 55 Norwegian kroner per share. And that is a huge upside of more than 200% from the current valuation. And as mentioned, this is not a valuation we have just provided. This is something the comparable companies are actually trading at. And as we show on the first slide, we have actually created equal returns in the other iGaming investments we have made. The last valuation method we use is a free cash flow valuation. And here you can see the same picture as we had before. Geek is currently trading at between 4.4 and 2.5 in free cash flow yield. And to our knowledge, this is the lowest free cash flow multiple for any company in the Nordics right now. And again, we think a fair free cash flow multiple should be at least in the high teens for a company of this quality. And again, that would put a huge upside potential in the stock, as this is like an asset-light business. This is a structural growth. They are helping, online retail business moving online. And they have quite a safe balance sheet now. So with this, I think I will end the presentation and let Nathaniel handle the Q&A.
Very good. Oops. Yeah. Thanks, Andreas. Very interesting presentation there. Reminder to please submit your questions through the Q&A panel at the bottom of your screen. At least it's at the bottom of my screen. If you're on a desktop, I forget where it is or where it might be on a mobile or on a tablet or anything like that. But first question here is, don't players such as DMY and Rush Street have an internal solution for Gig Core?
Yes, there is some operators, especially the big one, that have their own platform segment. So at least, Bet365, actually Bet365 use Playtech in the UK, but someone like DMI, Rush Street Interactive, they bought the platform from Oryx, so they bought basically the source code from one of Geek's competitors there, but they own the source code now and have their own platform this way. We also see someone like DraftKings have this, and some of the bigger operators in Europe like Unibet, etc., have this. But retail casinos, of course, don't have this as they're not online yet.
Right. Okay. I have a question here. I don't think you touched on the balance sheet much or at all. And you did mention they had a lot of debt before. Has that been restructured and had
They paid back half the debt in April this year when they sold the B2C business. So they got a lot of cash from this that they could use to pay down the debt. You can see the net interest being debt here is predicted to be 29 million euro at the end of this year. And based on our EBITDA multiple, that is, this is below one time EBITDA or next year's EBITDA. So it's, I would say it's quite a safe balance sheet now. And it only matures in the end of 2022. So they have a long runway to, you know, either pay it back or refinance it.
Cool. Another question here is who are the main owners? How is the CEO incentivized now through cash or I guess shares? Or other ways.
The main owners now is there was two big owners before, one called Borgen Holding, a Norwegian fund, and one called Optimize Invest was a Maltese-based fund. Those owners split their shares into the individual owners. So now they have six owners that is quite big in GIG. But actually, Symmetry Invest is you know, one of the, I think, the five largest shareholders now in GIG. I would say the owners there have, you know, a quite good track record in unlocking value in, you know, other investments. And I would say, you know, the CEO has, you know, an options program, and most of the insiders has been buying shares in the open market over the last year. So if you see the insider purchases over the last year, there's been basically only been insider buying.
Nice. Next, do you see Genius Sport or Bet Genius? Do you think they might be able to buy GIG in the next year to 24 months?
I think that is highly possible. Bet Genius is going, you know, with a SPAC on the US market now and will have a big cash position. And they specifically mentioned in their, you know, IPO prospectus that they're looking to buy technology companies that fits into their business. So I will definitely see that, you know, platform provider that they already have a joint venture with would be, you know, quite an obvious acquisition target for them.
All right. We've got several, couple more questions here. Do you have any calculations on depreciation and amortization for 2020 and 2021 compared to this year?
It will drop a lot next year. Okay. The thing was that they bought a lot of affiliate assets in 2017, and most of them was the amortizing over 3 years. So a lot of that runs off in September this year. So it will be low in Q4. And then it will basically run off through the 2021. And then it will probably match the CapEx in 2022. Yeah.
All right. Why hasn't the market reacted so far to these bullish arguments? This is a question we get a lot of times.
As I said, I think there is, two main reasons for it. One is that as the company has a, you know, an ugly past, so it takes time for someone to gain conviction in a new management team. And another thing, as I said, you know, there has been a lot of selling pressure from the founder and the co-founder that was sacked last year. So they own 10% of the company that they have basically been dumping in the open market. So we think that has put a lot of selling pressure on the company there.
All right. Any idea how many customers on the platform will be live this year? That's from the chat.
They have 15 signed at the end of Q3 and two more now in Q4. At the last conference call, the CEO said that in maximum 9 months, everyone will be live. So it will start in next month, and then, you know, gradually over the next 9 months, everyone will be live. But they do expect to keep signing, you know, maybe one operator each month from now on, and then maybe launch them in 2-3 months after signing. So we think at the end of next year, they could go from 50 in SaaS deal now to 40 next year.
Mm.
Operating, right. Paying fees, yeah.
Nice. Let me see here. If you compare GIG paid media to other companies, you touched on this. But what do you think we can expect going forward? What path is GIG most likely to take, do you think?
So what's interesting with paid media is you can only do this in regulated market. This is because like Google AdWords and Facebook and YouTube, et cetera, only allow you to put gaming marketing in regulated markets. So as more and more markets become regulated, there are more and more markets that GIG can put this paid media technology into. So we definitely see them moving away from just UK then to Denmark. And now they're actually quite big in countries like Belgium, Romania, and et cetera, that they're moving into. And also now in the US, they can do paid media.
All right. As far as the long-term future of the business, especially the B2B solution portion of it, a lot of bigger operators go in-house, and there are many providers for small players such as Playtech and GAN. So what do you think of the business long-term? It sounds like you like it, but yeah.
I definitely like it long-term as they help those retail casinos going online, and those retail casinos cannot, you know, take it in-house. You don't see like land-based casinos that sign a technology provider and then take it in-house. And to the contrary, we also see some big, as I mentioned, you know, both Kazumo there and Betsson that actually are choosing Gig as platform, despite the fact that they have their own platform. And we also saw like Flutter Entertainment, they now were going into, you know, they have their own platform, but they go into Colombia with another provider. They use GAN in the US. So even the big companies are using outsourced providers in different markets.
All right. Several more questions. I'm not sure we're going to get to most all these because we are running late, but what is the, what do you think is the largest obstacle to achieve your EBITDA margin goals for 2021 and 2022?
I think the largest one is actually to get the operators live and get them scaling up. So when an operator go live, they start to pay the fixed fees, but for them to generate a lot of revenue, they have to grow the business so that Gig can start collecting the revenue share. But you know, already in Q4 now, the company is guiding to around 32% EBITDA margins. So they are actually quite close to my target already now as we speak.
Any idea when you expect the company to break even, to reach break even?
On an EBITDA level, they should be profitable already in Q4 now, so this quarter.
All right, last question. Do you see the regulated markets in Germany and Holland? How do you anticipate those might be for this company?
So in Netherlands, Gig don't have any business on the platform. They did have some affiliate business 3 years ago, but they basically took all the commercials from their website 3 years ago. So that is really, really limited. They do have some business in Germany, and that will be like a short-term impact for them now here in Q4 and Q1. So I think the CEO told me they have around 5% of the media business in Germany, and a little more on the platform side. That will decline a little bit, but there will be like a short-term hit. And they should, based on their own guidance, they should be able to grow still both revenue and EBITDA in Q4 despite of this. And another thing that has happened now in Germany is that they're also signing big retail businesses. They signed the biggest retail business called Tipwin that they will help going live there. So even through the online providers they have now will decline a little bit, they will grow more than this by signing new deals.
Interesting. Very good. Okay, that's all the time we have for questions. I had one. This is about a previous presentation you made about 6 months ago.
Yeah.
About North Media, which you picked, you presented at our, I believe it was our second actual Contrarian Investor Conference in June. And which did very well, but you have since closed that position. And somebody wanted to know why you sold it and if this had anything to do with the risks, the regulatory risks that the business
was
facing.
Yeah, so we sold it for two reasons. One was the stock went up 30% in a month or so. So, you know, the upside to downside the ratio, you know, changed a little bit there. But the main problem we saw was that the leafless business was declining faster than we originally thought. And then there was two regulatory risks that came forward, both that the government was trying to basically they wanted to change the default rate from yes to leafless to no, so that people actually have to choose them by themselves. And the second thing was that the competitive authorities in Denmark actually charged them that they did illegal business there. So we didn't like the risk there for a fine or a changes to the model. So we thought it was better to wait on the sideline and take our profits.
All right. Andreas, thank you very much for this presentation. Very interesting.
No problem. As I said before, I will put the full report and the slides on the website in due course.
Great. And then also, do you have a slide here where you could provide your contact information, because I know that there are some, and again, apologies, I didn't get to all the questions. There are at least three or four that I had to dismiss, not because they weren't good questions, just because we are running behind here.
I actually don't think I have them here, but you can find them on the website. It's
symmetry. It's on the website.
Yeah, and you can see symmetry.dk.
Yeah, and your Twitter is symmetry invest. _invest. Yes. Yeah. And I believe I just retweeted you so you guys can see me. Yep. All right. Thank you so much, Andreas.